and we do not brush things under the carpet.
The IRA had become increasingly wary of Martin McGartland. Someone was passing details of planned attacks to the police, and he was the chief suspect. He was summoned to Connolly House, the headquarters of Sinn Féin. But before he went, he met his handlers.
A lot of people obviously got arrested and stuff over the months prior to that. And we were very suspicious, and obviously something was going to happen. And maybe this was more or less the call that I was expecting. So we come up with a plan that obviously suited myself and the special branch, and I was told that obviously to go ahead with the meeting and stuff, and their job was to keep a close eye on me, different ways that we're going to do it. And if I did have to get taken from the Sinn Féin centre, which we thought would happen, they would be very, very close by.
The RUC's concern for their agent's welfare was well founded. The man who had ordered the meeting was the IRA's head of discipline. When Martin McGartland arrived at Connolly House, he was met by two other men. They told him the meeting was to be held at a different location and they would drive him there. An attempt by the police to follow the car was to prove unsuccessful.
They got in a car and they broke a couple of red lights and stuff, and obviously people who were trying to follow me maybe couldn't, they didn't have an advantage. We drove to an estate about 4 or 5 miles away from Connolly House. It was up in the Twinbrook estate. I was brought into a flat, very, very top of the flats. It was about 30, 40 feet high. I didn't even get a chance to sit down, and one of them turned around and says, "Right, Marty, provisional IRA, you're under arrest." These people had us at gunpoint. They just kept basically saying, "Don't try nothing, don't try nothing." They put me on the floor, took shoes off, tied us up and stuff, with my laces, and put us on a settee, face down with a blanket over the back of my head. Now that's when I started panicking, because I says to myself, these people could have, probably taken over this house. They could very easily shoot me here, and just walk out and get their flat cleaned up and stuff, and get my body moved. I was waiting on, lights going out type thing, just black darkness, dead. Then I asked to kind of go to the toilet. So one of them came along and untied my hands, but my feet were still tied. So I hopped in, and when I went in, the bath had been filled up with water. Now when I seen that, I says, obviously these are going to use this for their torture tactics, putting people's head in the water until they get the drowning effect and pulling them back out again. And if they're not telling them what they want, they're back in again. They were in the kitchen, and I hopped back to the wall, and I just says to myself, these people are going to kill me here. There's nothing more certain than that. And I says, if I don't get out of here now, well, I've got the opportunity. I'm never going to get it. And if I didn't jump out the window, I mean, I was dead. So I just run across the sitting room, hop on, and jump through the window.
Concussed and bleeding, Martin McGartland was taken to hospital before his captors could reach him, then transferred to Palace Barracks. There he was debriefed before being flown out of Northern Ireland. While Martin McGartland embarked on a new life, the two men he claims abducted him went on to appear publicly in the company of Gerry Adams.
I have seen Jim McCarthy on Chico Hamilton in the last elections that Sinn Féin had there whenever they got the 15.5% vote. They were bodyguarding Gerry Adams and they were in the photograph in the photo call for Sinn Féin on the City Hall, and they were starting smiling and stuff.
Both men identified by McGartland have prison records. In 1977, Jim McCarthy was sentenced to 5 years for possession of firearms and ammunition. Paul Chico Hamilton was jailed for 12 years in 1979 for the attempted murder of an army major. In July, the men were named in the House of Commons.
The people I named in the earlier motion were Jim McCarthy and Paul Hamilton, the people who are commonly believed to have taken Martin McGartland to the flat in the Twinbrook estate, the ones who prepared him for the torture team, the interrogators, and the murderers, the killers, to come along. If I've named the wrong people, I hope that Mr. McCarthy and Mr. Hamilton will write to me and tell me. They haven't so far.